So the first thing we're doing here today is we are doing a pass between books 2 and 5. This is a lecture on books 3 and 4, The Education of the Guardians. Now, y'all recall that I said the other day that this is the structure of the city he's created. He's created the city, the republic, the res publica, the polis. He's created this thing in order to see justice written large. And he's done it as an extended metaphor, partly to also drag his interlocutors out of this dark worldview that they have into a light world view of the world, that has created the world of organized vision. So he has set up his structure of the world based on 3 divisions, which is the inverted golden proportion, the indefinite dyad that's been flipped, which we can also describe as those 2 interlocking triangles, 2 inverted triangles is another way of expressing the same idea. And the rulers, guardians, and workers correspond in the soul to intellect, high-spirited conscience, and appetitive. In books 3 and 4, then, he goes on and on at great length about the education of the guardians. Part of the reason I skipped it, because he does become kind of excessive about it. But there are certain things that are important to note. The education of the guardians he sees as crucial. This is very, very important. The main reason that he sees it as important is that he is tying together intellect to appetitive. And the only way to tie the two together is by educating this group in a specific way. Our intellect is tied to our appetitive realm by this conscience, this high-spirited part. And consequently, the high-spirited part has to be educated a certain way. Without appetitive, intellect becomes a sort of pie-in-the-sky, marble-towered, sort of removed-from-human-experience vision. And without intellect, appetitive becomes a sort of animalian, serving the baser needs type of person. And with the two united together, you get a full human being. To put this in another way, the human person is really fully human when he is stretched between these 2 apparently contradictory realms. It's the tension between intellect and appetite that actually makes a human being a human. And if I could wax eloquent on this for just a minute before I go into the education of the guardians, what he is describing here is essentially a Pythagorean idea. Because he's suggesting, I'm going to use this little space up here, he's suggesting in the Pythagorean mode that a human being is like a well-tuned string. The string only produces sound when it's stretched between 2 opposites. And in that tension, he says, between intellect and appetite, you get a human being. Humans are neither angels nor are they pigs. They are in between the two. So that this Pythagorean idea, suggestion, is that the human person is like a well-tuned string. Now, if I can make a quick transition here, which is a much of a transition. This same suggestion is that when we hold these 2 things that seem contradictory, when we hold them at the same time, we experience a strange, paradoxical sense of the world. We are pigs and we are angels at the same time. And that tension causes us to be racked, to be stretched. It's as though we are crucified. Crucifixion is the moment where a person is the most human, because they are at that moment stretched between 2 extremes. And that stretching between 2 extremes is what really makes us what we are as human beings. You can obviously see a connection, right? Remember that Adamantus said that the just man has 1 end result for his life. After being whipped and beaten and eyes poked out, he's going to be crucified. That's not an unintentional choice of words. because Adamantus is betraying right there a very philosophy of Plato, of Socrates. Human person is a person crucified. Now, you shouldn't go out and look to be crucified. I won't be human. No, that's not the point. The point is that in crucifixion, the stretching between two extremes, we find the example of what this tension between intellect and body is. Does that make sense? More or less?
Kind of.
Okay. Yes. The two extremes are, we are angelic, and we are animal. We are angels, and we are pigs. And if someone says, are we animals? The answer is yes. And if someone asks, are we angels? The answer is yes. We're both. How is that possible? I don't know. It just is. It's like, are humans capable of great, beautiful, noble, virtuous, honorable, self-sacrificing actions? Yes, of course we are. Can we think great thoughts and construct great, beautiful pieces of artwork? Yes, of course we can. Are humans capable of tremendously destructive, horrible, bestial acts? Can we abuse one another and annihilate the universe? Yes, we can. How is it that man is capable of this magnificence and this debauchery? How are we both minotaur and human? Is that possible? The answer is yes, absolutely. But to hold both at the same time, that you and I both are capable of tremendous thoughts and tremendously great deeds, and you and I both are capable of awful things, horrible actions, the worst actions you can conceive of, you can do. That's a tremendously difficult thing to hold, I think. Most people fall either saying humans are all good, it's all noble, we're all virtuous, or humans suck, either one. And both camps are wrong, Plato says. It's only this camp in between that holds the two tensions that is fully human. Now, in order to understand that, he suggests, the education of the guardians, the education of the conscience, has to be of a certain type. And he suggests that this education is based primarily on two pillars. The two pillars of the education of the guardians are music and gymnastics. Notice again, music and gymnastics, the same structure that we've seen prior to this, over and over, repeated. Together, music and gymnastics develop in a person a quality that he calls thumos. The Greek word is thumos. Thumos is manly courage. It's basically the proper human response to things. When you see something horrible, your proper response should be, I should stop that. It's the fireman running into the burning building, right? It's the policeman and the medics running into the Twin Towers. That's thumos. Your response should be like, ha, 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 look at the car wreck. That's a wrong response. And the only way to train this, he suggests, is by this dual training in music and gymnastics. The one, music, instills grace and ability to recognize beauty, what he calls kalos. The other one, gymnastics, toughens, grants the ability to defend the beautiful. So on the one hand, you have to recognize it, almost like it's second nature. It shouldn't be something where they think, oh, is that beautiful? No, it's like you recognize your own fingers. Are these my fingers? You don't have to be told that you are the one breathing. That's part of you. And beauty becomes part of you through an immersion in music, he suggests. But you also have to be able to defend that thing that you see as beautiful. If you can't defend that thing that's beautiful, then basically there's no reason for you to love it if you can't defend it. And so the ability to defend it is paramount. By music, though, by music and gymnastics, he means something different than what we conceive, and I need to explain this a little bit further. Gymnastics, the word itself, first off, means naked action. Gymnos is naked, no clothing, which is why a gym uniform has always struck me as an interesting concept. Why would you have a naked uniform? You know, it's like your birthday suit or something. Make for very interesting classes, I'm sure. Gymnastics, though, as he sees it, is not just the tumbling on the mat and doing headstands. it's really everything from learning flexibility and movement as good gymnasts do, all the way to learning how to use machetes and swords and spears and hand-to-hand combat. You learn Taekwondo, Jiu-Jitsu, Bushido, Aikido. You learn floor work. You learn how to fight the phalanx. It's learning strategy. It's learning how to defend yourself with a shield. It's all that stuff that goes into martial activity. So by gymnastics, he really means a training in martial activity, what we call the martial arts. That's gymnastics for him. He makes out some details, you know, men and women have to train together and all this, and we shouldn't laugh at the fact that they train together. Old men and young train together. Shouldn't laugh at it. But the main point is that everybody in the city that's a guardian has to be trained to do this action, be able to defend the beautiful when they see it. The second they see it, they recognize that they should be ready to defend it. The second thing, music, he doesn't mean just audible sounds. In fact, he goes out of his way to suggest that people that think that the audible sounds are real music are pedestrian. That's what the hoi polloi thinks, the common person thinks. When you hear music, that's only a physical manifestation of a much greater form of music. And what he says about music is it's really mathematics. He doesn't mean just audible sounds, but mathematics. Now, before you groan too heavily over this suggestion is taken from the Pythagoreans, who also say music and math are the same thing. Music, as we hear it, is simply a physical manifestation of a mathematical principle, what they call number. Music is mathematics. How to explain this better? First off, we'll take the scale of music. We're all familiar with that. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. Or da, 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 da. The words we use, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, a little bit of history, actually come from a piece of chant music in the roughly around the 9th, maybe 10th century. And the first line of each sequential line is on the next note up in the scale. And so what they did was in the era of Gregory the Great, they simply took that piece of music and they took the first word, assigning it to a note, and created the words that we use in that scale. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. The piece has different words. It's utque ad laxis resonare fibris, mi registrorum fabula tuorum. Solve polluti lavire artus sante Johannes. Which just goes right up the scale. And so we assign do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do to that scale. But the notes themselves aren't really do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. That's just a word choice that we use in order to have a convenient thing at our fingertips. Well, let's use that as our starting point. Here's the scale. When we take the scale, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, those same word choices for the notes can be assigned in numbers. So instead of singing do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, we can sing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And consequently, what we're really dealing with here is not just a series of notes. We're dealing with the relationships between numbers. When then we do a third or a fifth or an octave, we're actually doing the relationship of 1 to 3, and then 3 to 5, and then 5 to 8. 1, 3, 5, 1, 5, 3, 1. But that's a numerical relationship, see? What we hear is the vibration of the air that represents that relationship, one to the next. And consequently, the music that we hear is actually a study of, or is actually a representation of mathematics. Because if you take the numbers and you put them into formulas, or you put them into graphs, or you put them into geometric shapes, you're still dealing with relationships between numbers. And that relationship between numbers can be translated into a musical system. Let's look for a minute at this scale. When we go from do to do, do re mi fa sol la ti do, re mi fa sol la ti do, we repeat at do, so that 8 and 1 are the same number, the same note. And the next octave up is simply translated into the previous one. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. So you can see it as repeating in a circular pattern, well, it's not circular, it's spiralic. It comes back to the original spot, only it's translated slightly to a different octave. Perfect representation of what he's been talking about up to this point. Time, right? You come back to January again, only it's not January, it's a new place. Your birthday is, again, your birthday, only it's now you're like 7, you're 8, you're 9, you're 10. So that it represents time, the octave does. It also represents that spiralic movement that I suggested out of the golden portion. Very similar to it. So that music is itself a physical manifestation of these images that we've been using up to this point. Notice also that with music, when we deal with that relationship between numbers, we're dealing with something that occurs over time. Because if you have all the numbers on a stave, if you play them all at once, you have a big chord that would sound terrible. But when you draw them out over a series of staves, or a series of measures, you're actually dealing with time, which is the third dimension now. And those notes unfold over time, like events, distinct events over time. And the relationship between this event and that event is what makes the notes. So we get, Mary had a little lamb, little lamb, little lamb. It unfolds over time, and you hear it over time, rather than hearing it all at once. It'd be like, Mary. That unfolding over time is the third dimension, which again is another number. Because you have time signatures, 3 4s, 4 4s. And that time signature is also governed by number as well. If that's the case, folks, so you got the numbers themselves, the notes themselves being numbers, time itself being a number, the relationships between the notes being a number, and all those things are governed by numerical significance. What that implies then is that if you were to go backwards and take any number, it could become music. Music, number are the same thing. It's just that music is a physical manifestation of number. Here's where the education in music, I think, takes on a different dimension, because he also suggests that every physical object is governed by number. If every physical object is governed by number, and music is governed by number, what is every physical object, essentially? It's music. The relationship between me and the chair and you and the wall and the window and the tree is a musical relationship over the course of time, because time is unfolding even as we speak. So what we are really trying to get the guardians to contemplate is the relationship of the individual to everything else, the smaller to the greater, the one to the many. We're trying to get the guardians to begin contemplating a harmonious relationship that exists between all created things. Because within creation, the number itself is a base way of looking at these relationships, music, objects, you, etc., etc. So that music really takes on a dimension of not just beautiful harmony and proportion, but really a contemplation of the way that the entire created world fits together in harmony.